Forever we would love to stay in your presence, God. Thank you for each and everything you have done for us today. It's an amazing day, God. We just want to say thank you for the strength, for the life, for the divine protection we have today. We haven't given anything. Your love, God, is everything for us. We thank you, God. We want to worship you above everything you are. Thank you, Jesus. Open the ears of my heart, Lord. Open the ears of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the ears of my heart, Lord. Open the ears of my heart. I want to see you.
This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you.
I give you my life, Jesus, but I give you my life, and I give you my soul.
Have your way in our hearts, Jesus. Thank you. Majesty you are, Jesus. The reason of our songs today. You have found us like we are. You have changed everything, our story. You are a victory.
Sing the majesty. Sing the majesty. Your grace is found me just as I am. Empty-handed by your love in your hand. Sing the majesty. Sing your majesty. Forever I am changed by your love. In your presence of your majesty. Do you?
Praise the Lord, my dear friends. It's a privilege and an honor for me to be speaking to all of you this morning, and I pray that God is you're experiencing God in a new way, and Corona is going down, and praise God for that. And now, more than staying safe, I would like to suggest and I would like to let all of you know that get vaccinated as soon as you can, so that you can protect yourself and your family and your children and people around you, so that they can be safe from this Corona. Today I would like to talk to you about a topic, and if I had to name it, I would call it foundations. Today I want to talk about something called foundations. Today the passage that I'm going to take is from Matthew chapter 7 verse 24 onwards. And this is a very, very common story that all of us have heard many, many times. And it's a story that probably you already know. It's a story of people, of two men. One who builds his house on a rock and one who builds his house on the sand. And today, I just want to take out a few things from this story for you to understand and ask yourself where you are in regard to this story. When you think about this, in verse 24, it says that everyone that hears these words of mine and does them is like the wise man who built his house on the rock. It says, everyone who hears the words of mine. There are two main characters in this story. One is wise, one is foolish. And it says that both of them heard what was being spoken. So I want to, just for us to understand further, I want to compare them to two believers of a church, because they both heard the words of Jesus. So if they had to hear the words of Jesus, they had to be in some sort of proximity to him, close to him. So in just to conceptualize it to you guys right now, it could be some in some church setting where they would have heard the word of God or heard a preaching, but like they heard Jesus saying this. But the best thing is, here we see that both these people have a vision and a desire to build a house. I want you to know that each one of us in our lives, it says, the one who builds his house on the rock. Now let me just speak very briefly about this house. What is house? You know, this story is speaking about building a house. A house can be considered as a household, as your immediate family. We all want to build our family, right? We all want to make sure that we do something for our family. That's great. If you want to build your family, your household, this is a story that you need to listen. Second, if you want to build like the house of God, like the house of God is in the Old Testament is also known as a house. If you want to do something for the church, you need to listen to this story. And finally, it was called Israel as a people group was called the house of Israel. I want to compare that to a community. So if you want to do something for your family, if you want to do something for the kingdom of God or the church, or if you want to do something for the house of Israel or your community or the place where you live, you need to listen to this story very carefully. Both of them had a vision to build a house. And both of them probably even built a house. But today I want to let you know what was the main difference between the wise person and the foolish person. The main difference was the foundation. Now let me tell you about this foundation. What is a foundation? Foundation is a thing that we put first in a building. Foundation is not something that you can build a whole building over and then, oh, let me go change the foundation. No, foundation is the first thing. It's the most primary first thing that you do in your building. So what was the difference between somebody being wise and somebody being foolish? The first difference was the foundation. Now let me tell you a few differences. One built a house on the rock and one built his house on the sand. Now let me ask you, what's the difference of building a house on a rock? If you build a house on a rock, it is hard. It is sturdy. It cannot be moved. Ask yourself your foundations. You want to build your life. You want to build your church. You want to build your family. What are the foundations of your prayer life? What are the foundations of your knowledge of the Word of God? If your foundations, are they hard? Are they immovable? Is your character immovable? Is your love for God, is your loyalty for God, your integrity, your honesty, those characters and qualities that imbibe inside of you that make you who you are they immovable? Second thing, to build a house on a rock, it's not easy. Why? You have to drill the rock. Put the foundation on it. Put the things. You have to put a hammer and a this and a that. Now let's look at the sand. To build on a sand, it's not hard at all. It's very easy. Just go to the beach and say, I want to build a house there. It's freely available. But your foundation is soft. If you want to build on a rock, it's going to be hard, it's going to be sturdy, it's going to be immovable. But if you build on a sand, it's going to be soft, it's going to be of no stability and will not hold anything for long periods of time. What kind of foundations do you have? What kind of foundations are you giving your children? Many people, I feel, you know, I talk to many parents and they tell me that, my son, my daughter, they're doing this, they're doing that, they're into alcohol, they're into drugs, they're into this, into that. How did all that happen? They've built their lives, but it all begins with, what was the foundations that we had given them? What was it, an immovable word of God? Was it immovable flaws? Was it movable flaws? Was it the prayer being the utmost thing in your family? What is it? What are your foundations? Another difference between the rock and the sand. Rock is costly. Sand is easily available. Sand is cheap. If you want to build a big house, if you want to build a sturdy house, it's going to cost you your time. It's going to cost you your energy. It's going to cost you to let go of certain things and prioritize this. Because if you want to build a big house and if you want that foundation to be a rock, it's going to cost you something. You know, I love that verse. It's one of my favorite verses in 2 Samuel 24:24, which says, where David says, I will offer unto God nothing that doesn't cost me something. Amen. Many of us, we want God to do something in our lives, but we don't want to spend any of our time with Him. We don't want to spend our time, energy, money on Him. But we want to build a big house. We want to do something big, good for the kingdom of God. We want to change the community. We want to be like that televangelist. We want to be like that person. But how does it all begin? In before God uses somebody, you don't know the amount of time they've spent on their knees in prayer. The time that they've spent in learning the word of God. The foundations is the most important thing. Secondly, the difference between the wise and the foolish was, it says very clearly here, everyone who hears these words of mine and does them is like a wise man. The problem that we face in church people is both the church guys, both of them heard the message. Both of them go to church. Both of them heard the pastor. Both of them did praise and worship. But what was the difference that one was able to build his life and one was not able to build his life? You know what it was? It was application of the word of God in his life. Nobody cares how much you read the word. Nobody cares how much you memorize the word. Nobody cares how much you can recite the word. You know what matters the most? How much you're able to apply the word of God into actions in your life. Don't be hearers of the word, is what says in James chapter 1, but be doers of the word. Don't be hearers, but be doers. And finally, storms. It's so funny that both these believers, both these guys, both these buddies, they were in the same vicinity when the storm hit. What does storm signify? I want you to know that you may be having a cushion of crores of rupees in your bank. You may be having a cushion with a great life insurance, medical insurance, health insurance, educational loan, this, that, blah, blah. But you never know when the storms are going to hit in your life. You don't know what tomorrow holds. You don't know what can happen to your health, what can happen to your family, what can happen to your business. You don't know. They are storms. They signify circumstances, trials, tribulations, bad things that happen to us. But what makes us go through that? Not how big our house is, not with what our house is built of, but what our foundations are. Today, ask yourself this question. Have you fallen in a storm? Have you let go of Jesus because something bad happened to you? Don't blame the devil. Tell God, God, I'm breaking my old home and I'm beginning with a new foundation, which is Jesus Christ, because He is the rock of ages. Amen. He is the rock on whom we stand. Christ is the solid rock on whom we stand. All other ground is sinking sand. I love that song. Is Christ the rock on whom you stand? Is Christ the person who is the foundational basic of your life? If He is, I promise you, the house of your family will flourish. The house of God through your life will do great things. And the community, the house of your kingdom that you are a part of, your community, your culture, God will make you as flourishing so that people around you will see and experience God's presence through your life. I hope this word encourages you. Your foundations matter, not your house. God bless you real good. Thank you.
I greet you all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ this morning. My dear friends, we have gathered together again on this Sunday morning, the Lord's Day. We are here to worship our living Savior. And we thank God for this, always a privilege and the honor that God has given to us to worship our Lord. And our God is a good God. Yesterday is the 3rd of July, 2021. I don't know how many of you are aware that all the Christians in this country have joined together, and we have decided to celebrate one day as the memorial of Apostle Thomas, who came to India in AD 52. And of course, we have the honor and the joy of having him landing in this great state of Kerala in a little town called Kodungallur. And that was in AD 52. So the church leaders, not only in India, but every person who has got an Indian origin, have got together in the last 1 year and joined together to celebrate a day called the Indian Christian Day. That is to celebrate the day that Thomas came and he started preaching the gospel, conversion into Christianity. The Mar Thoma Church was formed, and then we go on that he moves on preaching the gospel from Kerala to Tamil Nadu, and there in the city of Chennai, the place which we call the St. Thomas Mount today, there he was martyred. He was stabbed by a javelin, a spear. And he died on AD 72. So yesterday was the day, and I had the opportunity and the privilege of being a part of the working group with all the different heads of the denominations. And we were able to celebrate. And we sent the messages. And even here in this Powervision TV, we have been promoting it, saying, join with us to celebrate the Indian Christian Day. So we call that in Hindi, Ishu Bhakti Divas. So the plan was to show to the government that we Christians are all united together to celebrate this day every year. July the 3rd, every year, we call for a celebration of one decade, 10 years, starting from this 2021, and it'll go all the way to 2030. So that is a plan. So yesterday, in many, many cities and many villages, people, even in the state of Kerala, that several celebrations have been organized, and maybe many of us were not aware of it, but doesn't matter. Because we have just started this, and this is going to be an annual day of celebration for all the Christians of Indian origin, because this is Thomas coming to India. So that was the main thing. And it is going to happen year after year, and we are hoping that we are going to bring to the notice of the government that this is a very important day for the Indian Christians. And maybe one day soon that the government will recognize this day. And the government may even declare it as a public holiday, just like Christmas and Easter that we celebrate every year. So that was yesterday. So we remember what Thomas did for us. The famous doubting Thomas, can you believe that? The one who demanded that if I don't put my hands into the wounds on his hands, into the wounds on his sides, I will not believe. So you imagine, he was the only one who demanded that. Because when Jesus revealed himself to the disciples, Thomas was not there. But very interestingly, you see that Jesus came another day into the same house, same room, where all the disciples were gathered together. And when he came inside, and as if that he came only for Thomas, because he is looking around and he says, "Where is Thomas?" And he looked at Thomas and he said, "Thomas, come over here. Put your hands in my wounds. Put your hands on my side and see the wounds that I took on the cross." And his legs buckled. He fell down on his knees and he called him my Lord and my God. You might wonder why on earth Jesus came all the way just for a doubting Thomas. Why did he do that, Lord? You should have ignored him. You should have said, he did say that to him, it would have been better for you to believe without seeing. But Jesus took the pains, the effort to come to reveal himself to Thomas. You know why? Because only Jesus knew. To others, he was this famous doubting Thomas, the man who will not believe, the man who challenged the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But to Jesus, he knew that this man, the one who is on his knees in front of me, who is calling out and saying, my Lord and my God, Jesus knew that he is the one, more than any other disciples, more than Paul, more than Peter, John, James, everyone, you name it, he is going to be the only one who is going to get on a sailboat, who is going to travel the farthest distance, traveling from the Middle East, coming through, maybe going around the continent of Africa, I don't know. Because in those days there was no Suez Canal to cross. But he traveled for months, all alone in the boat. Nobody was going with him. Nobody traveled with him. All alone. He came and landed in the dark continent of India. AD 52. Jesus knew that. Jesus knew there is a country with lots of people. Among all the other nations, even that time, a large number of people who need Jesus Christ. And he came and rewrote the history of India. Christianity was born. He converted the Nambudris, the Brahmin priest, to Christianity. Established the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Today we rejoice. Today we claim that we are a group of Christians who have got a tradition of 2,000 years. Praise the Lord. Amen. Most of the people in this country and most of the people of other religious groups, even the other organizations who are not very happy with Christians, they think that Christianity is a Western man's religion. They think that Christianity came through the Britishers or some Swedish and some Portuguese. They believe that Christianity came by giving them wheat and milk powder and converting the Dalits, converting the low caste people of this country. They have no idea that Christianity is one of the religions, if you call it a religion, has been founded and rooted in this country for 2,000 years. More than many other so-called Indian religions we claim for. Hallelujah. And I believe it's a befitting thing to celebrate a day. We call it Indian Christian Day, commemorating the arrival and the ministry of St. Thomas in the nation of India. Amen. Today I'm going to start. I may not be able to finish what I wanted to preach, but I want to share with you the two banquets of Queen Esther. Queen Esther arranged two banquets for two important men in the whole country, actually, and nations, 127 countries, from India to Ethiopia. She arranged this banquet for two people. One is King Ahasuerus, of course, her husband. This is Queen Esther. The other one was the most prominent, the number one in command of all the princes of that nation, a man by name Haman. Haman, you can call it. And let me read the two verses as we'll kickstart the message. And maybe if I'm not able to finish, I'll finish it next week. So we can start that. It is in the book of Esther, chapter 5. And we are going to read verse 3. And the king said to her, "What do you wish, Queen Esther? What is your request? It shall be given to you up to the half the kingdom." Many times the kings offer that. You remember when King Herod, when the daughter of Herodias danced and made him happy, he's still offering, "You can have a half of my kingdom." That's a big offer. Willing to give to somebody half of the kingdom. So this is the offer given to Queen Esther. But what did Esther say? Verse 4. And Esther answered, "If it pleases the king, let the king and Haman come today to the banquet that I have prepared for him." That's banquet number one. And then we read that in verse 8. This is after the first banquet was over. And the king asked again the same question. At the banquet, the wine was served. The king said to Esther, we read it in verse 6, "What is your petition? It shall be granted you. What is your request? Up to half the kingdom. It shall be done." And here is verse 8. And he says, "If I have found favor in the sight of the king, and if it pleases the king to grant my petition and fulfill my request, then let the king and Haman come to the banquet which I will prepare for them. And tomorrow I will do as the king has said." Amen. Verse 4 is banquet number 1. She said, "I request the king and Haman to come for the banquet that I prepared for him." And now in verse 8, she says, "You are asking me to ask anything even up to the half of the kingdom. But my request at the moment is I want you and Haman to come once again, to the banquet that I prepare for." That's banquet number 2. Yes, sirs, two banquets that changed the history. That changed the history of the Jewish race in those days. Amen. We know the background of the story. Haman hated only Mordecai. He doesn't know anything much about the Jewish race. He is upset with one man who is a soldier in the army of the king. He was a Jew. And he was there at the gate of the king. And whenever Haman came out of the court of the king, when everybody jumped up and fell down on their faces, showing respect to Haman, there's one man who is not showing respect, who is not falling on his face. And that man was Mordecai. So there is an enmity, there is a hatred in the heart of Haman for one man. And what he, you know what he says? It's too easy for me to kill him. Just one soldier. How long it will take for me to destroy this man? It will not take long. So he did his study. And then he found out he is from the Jewish background. And there is a Jewish race is scattered right across the nations that are ruled by King Ahasuerus. And Haman says, it is not to my stature to fight with that little Mordecai. So to teach him a lesson, what I'm going to do, I am going to kill the whole Jewish race. He was very cunning. That is how he came to this position. He was able to convince the king how he could be the best man that he could have. And he rose into the ranks. And he became the number one in the kingdom. That's what you read in chapter 3, verse 1. And there we read like this. And after these things, King Ahasuerus promoted Haman, the son of Hammedatha, the Agagite, and advanced him and set his seat above all the princes who were with him. It was the cunningness, the craftiness of a man that convinced the king. And the king had to make the decision that he is going to promote him to be number one. And that's how it was. And you know what he did when he became number one? He could not think about anything else. He wanted to destroy one man. A God's child. One from the chosen people of God. The one who will not worship anybody except the living God. That was his problem. And because of him, he convinced the king that there is a group of people who are not good for us, who create problem for us. We have to get rid of them. And I'm going to give you so much of silver into the treasury. He convinced the king one more time. He has done it many times. That's how he became number one. And the king always listened to him. He was not giving too much of thoughts of what this man was saying. He took his signet ring and gave it to him and said, okay, do whatever you want. And the decree was made. It was sent to all over the 127 provinces, the nations, that the king was ruling. To say that on this such and such a day, that everyone of the Jewish people should be killed. So that was the decision that was made. So Mordecai immediately tore his clothes and he started to sit on the ashes, wearing sackcloth, crying before God. Not for him, but for the human race, for the Jewish race. He's praying and crying to God to have mercy. He doesn't know, because the law of the Persian Media that cannot be changed. And the decree of the king has already gone. And every non-Jewish people are getting ready for that day. So they can not only kill the people and loot, and they can plunder and take all the riches of God's people. That was the plan. So we read in chapter 4. Mordecai sends word to Esther, because Esther found out that her uncle Mordecai is sitting there in ashes, wearing sackcloth. She did not know what it was. So he sends the message to Esther saying what was the plan of Haman. And he gives her a word. Though you are a queen, you are still one of the Jewish girl. You are one of the Jewish persons who belong to God. And she says, you have been brought into the kingdom in such a time as this. Don't think that you have been made a queen for your beauty. Not that the king got excited about you. No, there's a plan and purpose for you in your life. That you have been brought into this position as a queen. He says, in such a time as this, remember this, in every one of our life, God puts us in a position. We think that it is because of my ability. It's because of my talent, my education. No, my dear friends. God has placed you in this place for only one reason. Because it is such a time as this. And a warning, if you won't rise up, and if you don't do something, remember this, God will raise up somebody else because God has to save his people. You know that? God will save his people. God will save you and me. No matter who rises against Christianity, no matter who fights against us, no matter how strong the force is, always remember, my dear friends, our God will rise up for us. Our God will protect you and me. God's powerful hand will be upon our life. And he said, if you don't rise up, remember this, God will raise up somebody else and God will save his people. But you and your household will perish for sure. Esther got the message. And Esther sent word to Mordecai saying, you know the law of the country. I have not seen the king for more than 1 month. I have never been called by the king. And nobody is allowed to go before the king, before his throne, unless he has been summoned by the king. But I have not been called. But then you know, if you walk before the king without his calling you, without his permission, and you could be put to death. That is what is in front of me. So what do you want me to do? And then she decides and she says, okay, I will go. I'm going to stand before the king, though I have not been invited, though I have not been called. I'm going to stand before the king. And the king is not pleased with me. Then, I don't know what's going to happen. But let me say this. If I perish, I perish. That was the decision that Esther made. She went before the king. And she found favor in the sight of the king. The king stretched out his scepter. And she went and touched. And then our story begins. I'm sorry, friends. This is where I'm going to finish today. But we'll continue on with our two banquets when I come to you next week, next Sunday. So the king asked her, what do you want me to do? What is your request? And Esther says, nothing. I don't want your half of your kingdom. I don't want anything else. I have a plan. I want you and Haman to come for a banquet, a feast, a royal feast that I have prepared for the king. And I want one more person to come. That is Haman. And please come to my palace and let me treat you with the royal banquet that I prepared for you. Amen. That was banquet number one. And the king and Haman went to the banquet. Amazing food. So amazingly prepared. And Haman and the king ate and drank. They were so pleased. King was happy. Ain't nothing big deal because she is his wife. But Haman was ecstatic. I was the only one who was invited by the queen for this special banquet. And he gets out of the banquet of Esther, singing, jumping, dancing on his way home. The rest of the story, we'll look at it next Sunday. God bless you. Heavenly Father, we praise you and we thank you, Lord, for today. Thank you for your presence. Thank you, Lord, for your anointing. Thank you, Lord, for your power in our life. Father God, as we have just lay down the foundation of these banquets of Esther, as the people will be preparing themselves for next Sunday. I pray your blessing will be upon us, Lord, that you'll help us to see the two banquets in the eyes of the Lord. I bless everyone. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. God bless you, my dear friends. Take care of yourself. God loves you very much. And God's hand is upon us. Be careful. Kerala is not doing well. We don't know what the problem is. More than 10,000 cases. We need God's mercy. Please pray. And also be safe. God bless you real good.